In this video, we're going to make this sheath for a K-bar knife. Now, K-bar is a very popular knife, so hopefully people will find it useful. This is the fourth video that I've done off the back of the requests video, because quite a lot of people said that they wanted help in sort of the drawing up and design aspects of the sheath, you know, how you actually come up with the measurements and things like that. As such, I've done this video in sort of three parts. The first part is going to be how to sort of draw up the sheath, you know, on paper, make an actual pattern. The second part is talking about different ways of doing the belt loops, and, you know, how you want to go about accommodating the guard of the knife and making enough space for the guard to get in there. And then the third part of the video is actually making that sheath there. And then the actual making of the sheath is just the last 10 minutes or so. So if you do only want to watch the sheath get made, click the index in the description and just go watch the last part if you're not interested in actually learning how to design it. There's no point really me making lots of different videos about how to do the same sheath for lots of different knives, because I haven't got time. What I've tried to do is, in this video, I've tried to get in the general concepts, sort of design concepts that I use, and show you lots of different options in the middle section so that you can sort of take any similar knife that you've got and manage to make a sheath for it. Because obviously learning how to do it yourself is better than sort of hunting around trying to find specific instructions, because that's just not really going to work. I've pulled out three examples just because, you know, the ideas that are going to be in the sheath, you're going to be able to adapt to different types of knives, but some of the ideas are only going to work for particular styles of knives, because you need to make a sheath that's appropriate for the type of knife, obviously. Well, so if you think about some of the characteristics of a dagger, none of these are flared blades, so the blade is generally widest at the ricasso area, and then it's either straight and tapering, or tapering all the way down like the fairbairn there. So there's no sort of blade swells to deal with. These have all got guards on. Obviously that's a smaller guard, that's a larger guard. They've all got a guard on, and a guard gives you a very positive area to get a retention strap over. So on a knife without a guard, you sometimes struggle if you want to use a retention strap, because there isn't the contour there really to get the retention strap around and make that a really secure fit. Any knife that has a guard, if you put the retention strap over the guard, there's none of this sort of, well, it's secure, but if I pull it hard enough, it's going to come past the retention strap. It's not coming past that retention strap, so these give you good options for the retention straps. On any knife that's got a double guard and a single edge, such as the K-bar, I would always bring the retention strap over the top guard, and that way, when you unsheath the knife, you're bringing the non-cutting edge past the retention strap, and you're removing then the danger of cutting the retention strap. So, piece of graph paper. Obviously, if you're in America, you might be using imperial marked graph paper, which might have sort of quarter inch squares on or something. This is metric graph paper, so these are square centimetres with mil squares on. Really doesn't matter what you're using. So I'm going to lay the knife down, and I'm going to move in a couple of centimetres from the bottom, put the point of the knife there, and then I'm going to look about where the guard comes and make a little mark. What I'm then going to do is, I'm going to mark that line horizontally down the paper, like so. The next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to fold the paper on that line. I'm then going to take this marble, but you can use a block of wood or anything like that. I'm going to place the fold on the paper up against the edge of the marble, and then I'm going to lay the knife down against the edge like that, and what that's letting me do is just put the blade flat to the paper without tilting it up in the air, because that's going to introduce some inaccuracies. Now, the first thing you need to think about when you're playing this down is, are you drawing out a left-handed sheath or a right-handed sheath, because otherwise you're going to end up flipping your knife straight away. And the way that I generally try and remember that, if you can't remember, is just lift the whole thing up and put it on your hip. So if I lift this up and place it against my hip, it's going to look like a right-handed sheath, and just imagine yourself laying that sheath down again flat. But for the sake of this video, it being a right-handed sheath, the blade is basically facing away from me. So what I'm doing then is I'm just pulling the guard
into the edge of the marble, and then we're going to draw around the blade as accurately and as neatly as I can. Then we can unfold that, and we're basically, what we've got there is an accurate mark out of the blade. What I'll do then is I'm going to line that back up, and then I'm going to draw around the handle. Now the handle, drawing around the handle doesn't need to be as neat as the blade, because we're not fitting all that accurate to the handle. It's just going to show us how far it's coming. So what I'm going to do then is I'm going to draw down around this blade and make sure that I've got it straight on the measurements on the paper, because as you've sat that on the paper you may find it's come off line a little bit. What you want to do is get an actual sort of true straight measurement there. So just with a pen, I'm going to mark essentially the parallel lines, because it is a parallel blade. And when you mark these down, if you allow just a millimetre or a couple of millimetres gap, then really that should be all that you need. You don't need a big extra gap, because it's just going to try and wobble inside the sheath. But you do want a sort of just a small extra millimetre, so you can see there that basically where that ricasso comes out at the mouth, it's flush, which means it will catch into the mouth a bit, which is a good thing. And then as that makes that small gap there as it comes down the blade, that's essentially the allowance that I'm allowing there just inside. So we've got essentially two parallel marks marked there. Now the next thing that I'm going to do is I'm going to go back to my pencil and I'm going to mark a centimetre all the way around the outside of the blade parallel. And a centimetre is the allowance that I would allow for a standard welt. What I would do is I would have a centimetre, then I would have a stitch line at 5mm, which is going to be in the middle of the welt. So we've started marking there the welt essentially. The other thing to mention here is that if you're insistent on double stitching around, then you would need to increase the size of the welt to accommodate the double stitching. So for example, stitching at 5mm, if I was double stitching this, I'd make that 15mm on the welt, and I'd stitch at 5 and 5, so you'd have 15mm broken into 3. So we've marked those parallel lines there, or started marking those parallel lines there. The next thing to do is to come down to the tip of the knife and just mark a little vertical at the point where we're coming down there. And then we want to come 10mm away from that to find out where we want the bottom of the welt to come to. So that gives us the margin at the bottom there. Now, the other thing you need to think about at this point is if you want any sort of leg tie downs, so you want somewhere to, you know, stick a piece of thong or paracord or something through to tie this to your leg, generally you're going to need to accommodate that at the bottom of the knife somewhere. There's three or four different ways to do that. A lot of times people use a tab, so they'll have something sticking out of the welt, and that's what you put your tie down on. Personally, I don't like doing that, because I think over time, if that gets ragged around when it's on your leg, eventually you're possibly going to snap that and it's going to be nigh on impossible to repair. So generally, if I do a tie down, I try and actually oversize the welt and put holes that run actually right through the welt, which is through three layers of leather. You're never going to wear that out. So if you did want to accommodate a tie down, then this would be the area to do that. In this case, to keep things nice and simple, we're not going to do that. So with that marked in, we can then basically bring this 10mm around the curve at the bottom of the knife. So to do that, what I need to do is first draw a curve in here. To do that, I'm going to use one of these. This is a flexible curve. This has been in other videos, and people seem to think this is something that's hard to find. Any decent stationery shop should sell these. It's just a standard kind of art drawing type thing. There's nothing special about it at all. Trying to get my not this tripod over. So maintaining that couple of mil gap there, I'm just going to draw around the contour of the blade. Then what I'll do is I'll make a series of marks at 10mm away from that line. And then what we do is simply connect through those dotted lines down to the bottom, and you could do that freehand if you wanted, or you can use the curve. Do those like that, and then that then gets you your 10mm parallel. And then I'll do the same thing just here as well. To be honest, there's a very slight clip on the blade there, and to be honest, in this instance, it's so slight, if we draw that in as a straight line, I would be tempted not to do that as a curve. I don't think it'll particularly add much to the sheath, so if we connect that as a straight line there, what we can actually just do is do that as a parallel line, and given how much the sheath will grip the blade here, that's not really going to introduce any wobble. If that was more of an extreme clip point, you may want to have another curve there. And these are all decisions that you would need to make individually per knife that you were doing. So the perpendicular lines marked, you can just come down those by the distance that you're trying to measure. And then you can draw another line through those. See where that's going to intersect that vertical line. And then when we get down to the bottom here, we just want to curve that in nicely. So continue that line down. Come back with the curve there. Okay, so all we've done there essentially is draw around the blade. We've added a very small allowance inside just so that it's not literally scraping its way down the inside of the sheath. So literally just a mil or a couple of mil. And then we've added a 10mm border all the way around the outside. As I say, if you work into imperial measurements and you're used to doing that, then you probably have that at half an inch, and you'd probably be making quarter inch stitch lines. Half an inch is about 12mm, so that's 10mm. So there's not a great difference there. It's just that I'm used to adding about a centimetre. But you know, don't, if you're used to working in imperial, don't worry about trying to force yourself to do that. Half an inch and quarter inch is absolutely fine. So that's that bit, part of that draw note. Now, depending on what kind of sheath you were making, if you were making one of these blade-only type sheaths where you were going to either not have a belt loop at all, it was going to be one of these like stick-it-in-your-belt type things with a stud on, or you were going to make that but then add a frog system, then you would be done with that part of the sheath. And we'll discuss that in a little while. What we're going to do with this, though, is... we're actually going to make a belt loop as such, integral belt loop. So the next thing that we're going to do is we're going to work out how far up the handle we want the belt loop to come. Now that is completely personal preference. It's not going to affect the knife retention or anything like carefully measuring this part out. It's absolutely up to you. So if you were to put the belt loop there and make the handle come flush, then you wouldn't have any handle up above your belt line. The handle, the top of the handle there would sit flush with the belt line. You could come a little bit down the handle, which would be the usual thing to do. That would then lift the top of the knife here up above the belt line. You could drop it well down below the belt line if you wanted something that was really deep carry. You could actually, you know, so it was a little bit further down your leg, you could actually extend the belt loop up above the handle. All this is personal preference, so, but what would be most common, I'm not saying correct, what would be most common would be to come a little bit down the handle and have it extending up above. So what we'll do is we'll come down here and we'll mark a line which is going to serve to show where the belt loop is going to fold. And you can look at that by eye. I've not particularly measured that, but there's about an inch there, or 2.5 centimetres. That's what we'll show as being the fold there. So what we need to do now is we need to think about the total length of this belt loop. Now, one thing you'll notice is that we're going to run out of paper, because even though this is A3, you're going to find that that ends up being a lot bigger. This pattern's going to be digitised, which I'll talk about shortly. So I will do that in the digitising. If you wanted to do this completely in paper, you'd need to be working on bigger paper. So if we were to bring this up straight, which we won't do, but if we were to bring this up straight, we could then connect this point here, which is the top of the welt up there, and the top of the welt there, this belt loop is going to come up here. It's going to fold over at this point, and it's going to come back on itself, and it's going to come behind here. So it's actually going to be longer than that distance, and then there'll be a section from about here to about here which will be tapered, and it'll sit behind the welts. So what we do then is we come back to this side of here and we mark how much we're going to taper in. And again, you're going to want an inch or so. So I'll mark a faint line across there. So the distance that we've got then from there to there is the part that we're going to tie in behind the welt and behind any other pieces that we put in here. So what we can then do is we can say that the distance from here to here, so that's the distance from where the end of the tie-in section is to the fold, needs to be added here, if that makes sense. So if I measure that up, if I look like I keep flipping between centimetres and inches, by the way, that's because I'm a child of the 1980s UK education system, which is basically after the UK went metric, but before anybody in the UK bothered being metric. And I have the most convoluted day-to-day set of weights and measurements you would not believe. I measure some things in inches, I measure some things in centimetres, and don't cross over. So, for example, any short things I would always measure in centimetres, but if I was measuring my waist, I'd always measure it in inches. If I was measuring my height, I'd always measure in feet in inches. Weights and measurements, if I was weighing some post, I'd always weigh it in grams. If I was weighing myself, I'd weigh it in stones and pounds. Temperatures is an interesting one, because I measure any cold temperatures in Celsius and warm temperatures in Fahrenheit, which means that on a cold day, I like to know if it's above or below 0 Celsius. On a warm day, I need to know whether it's like 70, 80, 90 or 100 degrees Fahrenheit. It's ridiculous. So I will chop and change completely between metric and imperial. So if you see me messing about saying that's about an inch, that's a centimetre, it probably seems weird, but to be honest, I do it anyway. But that's not really relevant to this, is it? So I've got there 13 centimetres. So what I would do then is, to that side of that line, I'm going to write plus 13 cm. And I know that that means that I need an extra 13 centimetres, which would be off the paper. It would be about there, which would then fold over, match this section, and add that amount there. And that's going to, as you can tell, create really quite a long strip for the back of this. So the next thing that we need to think about is shaping for this belt loop. Now, you could just have a belt loop that was just completely straight up and completely straight down. Couple of things, that tends to look very blocky design wise. It doesn't always look that nice. It's kind of a bit utilitarian looking, if you like. A bit of shaping is often nice. And also, you need to think about where the retention strap is going to be, and if you need to accommodate where that retention strap will be installed and how it will get around the leather. This is all going to make a bit more sense once we actually look at this in pieces. So if we just lay the knife back down, lay the knife back down again there for a minute, thinking about retention straps, there's a couple of different things we could do here. We could have a retention strap which came from in between the two parts of the belt loop, over this guard, and press studs to the front. That would be my usual way of doing a retention strap, because it's the easiest to get the knife out, and it's pretty reliable and so on, and it's quite easy to sort of get the right tension and things like that. You could also have a retention strap which wraps around the handle, and this is going to depend a little bit on the particular knife that you're talking about, because some knives have a lot more contour to the handle than others. And anything that's got a very shallow contour, you need to avoid doing that, because you would be relying on sort of friction, and it's really not a secure fit. So what I need to think about is, when this piece of leather comes over the front here, how am I going to get that retention strap over and attached to the front. Now, if this was straight here, the retention strap would try and come out a long way before it came back, and it wouldn't look neat and it wouldn't be nice. So what I basically need is I need a cutout in this sort of area here for that retention strap to then come over and pull nice and tight and pull nice and neatly. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do two things. On this side of the belt loop here, I'm going to add basically a nice curve. And that curve, if you, as I say, because this is doubled over, would essentially look like a curve there and a curve there. And that's not going to serve any constructional purpose as such. It's just going to thin down the belt loop and it's going to give it a nice angle so it doesn't look so blocky. So that's all that needs to be done at this stage for drawing this pattern out. Now, if you weren't digitising the pattern, which I appreciate that the vast majority of people aren't doing, obviously you would have wanted to expand that out onto the top side of the paper if you want to, or make sure that you know exactly which parts of this you're cutting out. But the next stage for me is going to be digitising this pattern up, so I'll do that now. Okay, you've just watched a little bit of speeded up footage of me actually vectoring this up. Now, I did a whole video about vectoring up patterns, or an example of vectoring up a pattern, so that's why that's not been, you know, included in any great detail. Any patterns that I do, which I'm possibly going to recreate, so that would be for production nights like this K-Bar, I always vector them up. I have talked about this in the past, and as I say, I appreciate that not everybody wants to go to the trouble of doing this, or sees the need of doing it, but to me, it's something that I like to do. If you trace up the pattern on the computer off the paper pattern that you've done, there's several distinct advantages to doing that. Firstly is accuracy. If you obviously make a paper pattern, you know, when you draw it up, you can, when you vector it up rather, you can make sure everything is absolutely square and true and parallel and as perfect as it can be. Obviously with your pencil, especially if you do a lot of rubbing out, you can get where, you know, you make some mistakes and so on. You know it's dead accurate when you do this. If you need to adjust anything, it's a lot easier to adjust once you've vectored it. So if I, when we mock this up in a minute, you know, if I decide I need an extra little bit here or a little bit less there, rather than trying to adjust that piece of graph paper, I can just accurately knock off or add on any measurements that I need on the computer. Again, very, very accurate. If you want to do left and right handed sheaths and you get a bit confused with how you're using the pattern and what side of the leather you're marking and so on, I can select all that in Illustrator, press one button and flip it to the opposite way around, and then I've got an opposite side pattern. So that's very useful. If I need to recreate this, if it gets lost, you know, if it's stored on the computer, I can just print it, comes out of the printer. I don't need to worry about keeping them in a file or anything like that. Similarly, if I was to damage a paper pattern, or lose it or something, it's gone. This can be recreated. And then finally, the other thing that I do is I sometimes get parts laser cut. Now, as soon as you vector something up, there's websites where you can upload that and get that laser cut out of acrylic. Or you can, you know, there's companies that you can send your artwork to and they'll laser cut those pieces for you. So if you do want accurate CAD or acrylic templates laser cutting, which will always be more accurate than ones you've cut out by hand, then you can actually get that done. So anyway, what I've got done there is got that drawn up. Now I can actually stick these pieces together and we can mock this up. Now I've only got an A4 printer, and obviously this piece is bigger than A4, so what I do there is I print that out. When you're printing Illustrator, you can kind of move it around on the screen, and if your artboard's bigger than your paper, you select which bit you want to print. So all I do is print it out in two different pieces. Then I can... The other advantage to doing your vectoring, of course, is that you can explode your diagram out into different pieces very easily. So rather than trying to use one piece which has, you know, your welts and your back and your front marked all together, you can explode that out and actually have different pieces. And you can work with one pattern, but everybody who's done a lot of leather work will have done that, and at some point, you know, accidentally marked a welt on the front of some leather or something like that. It makes life easier when you actually explode these pieces out like that and know that they'll line up 100% because it's a computerized diagram. So that's three pieces together there that we've got. Finish with that last for now. So the next thing to do, just to make sure that we're happy with the overall shape of this, is to make a little mock-up. We still haven't talked about the 3D aspect of it. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But just to give an idea, we're going to do this first. Now, this is a fairly recent idea, which I picked up off a lady called Catherine Louise. She has an outfit called Catherine Louise Leather Designs. And she posted a tip-up on her Facebook page, which was... Rather than wasting a lot of leather doing prototypes, you can buy this stuff, which is craft foam, which is designed for kids to do whatever kids do with stuff like this. Rather than using leather, obviously this stuff's cheap. This comes in quite big sheets for about 80p a sheet, which is like a dollar or something. So it's pretty cheap stuff, but it's a lot better for doing mock-ups than paper is, because folding up paper and trying to pretend it's like leather doesn't work at all. Because paper's too thin, so it gives you a rough idea, but it's very unreliable. This stuff, because it's a couple of mil thick, is actually quite a good approximation of leather. So what you can do is you can treat this just the same as you would the leather, and actually cut some pieces out. So I'll do that now. Once you want to stick some of these pieces together, just so they hold the shape while you're messing about, a little bit of double-sided tape works quite nicely rather than messing about with glue. And you can, obviously it doesn't fold exactly like leather, but it, just for this mock-up stage, it works quite well. So I've got the back piece there. I've folded that back piece over, and I've got my little foam welt, and I've got my little foam front piece, so you can actually start to see the shape quite nicely of the sheath straight away. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just actually going to stick in my little foam welt as well. There we go, there's our little mock-up of our sheath in funky purple and orange foam. Now this probably seems a bit daft, and it probably seems like overkill, and you're probably thinking, I just want to cut some leather, this is a waste of time. But to be honest, if you don't do prototyping of any kind and you just crack on cutting leather, unless you're very experienced, there's a fairly high chance that something's going to go wrong, and all you're going to do is waste time and waste leather. It's much better to put the effort in at the start to give yourself the confidence in your pattern so that you know your pattern's right, and then once you start cutting your leather, you know that you're not going to, you know, get 4 or 5 hours down the road and then realise that you'd sort of fundamentally done something wrong. So there's the leather, there's the foam rather, and obviously if you imagine inside there, we've got this welt running around that you can't now see that we drew up that looks like that. So we've got this 10mm welt, which is allowed for where we'd have a stitching line, which would come down here like this, and up there like that. And we should near enough be able to actually insert this knife in this foam sheath. Now, what we need to, obviously, just to say that as well, this isn't going to protect your hands, so don't do what I nearly just did then and grab that and pull that knife out. You need to be very careful dealing with a live knife and something like that, because obviously you're going to cut yourself if you're not careful. Just to be clear as well, when I said this was new to me, I meant the foam, not prototyping. I've always done this, it's just I've normally used card or paper, and this stuff is just a bit easier. So I'm happy with the general shape off the bottom of the sheath there. So the way that this strap will be fit is, the end of this, bearing in mind there's no skiving or anything going on, the end of this will be skived, this will all be skived, and this strap will fit down here in between these two layers of leather. It'll all be skived, it'll be riveted in, so you'll be able to see two little rivets on the back. That's generally how I do that. I don't think there's anything offensive about two small rivets there. And then that'll be angled, and the angle of this strap will match the angle of this cutout section here, which is about 45 degrees, and that'll look like that. Again, I'm going to carefully insert that knife. And what I'm going to do then is I'm basically just going to look at where I've set the strap and whether that looks like that's going to come over here okay, the angle's going to be okay, there's going to be space for the press stud and so on, and that's all going to work. Okay, so what I want to talk about now, before I actually get on to making this particular sheath, is how to deal with the 3D aspect of it. As I was saying, we've essentially drawn this up in two dimensions. We've worried about the width, we've worried about the height, we've talked about how it folds and so on. That's all two-dimensional. If we flip this on its side, and we flip the knife on the side, we've got this third dimension to deal with as such. And this isn't really to do with the depth of it, because the depth will be however it stacks up. The bit that we're worried about is this section on the knife right here. Okay, and that is the distance between the blade stock and the end of the guard there. And this varies quite dramatically from knife to knife. This could be, you know, the handle could taper right down nearly to the blade. You could have a gentle transition, and this isn't really something to worry about. Or on a knife like this, you could find that you've actually got quite a big distance stacked up there. Now, if we look at our foam thing that we've made here, if we shove this knife into this foam thing, of course, the foam bends out of the way, and I can bend the foam up the back there, and you can find that that all kind of squashes. Leather doesn't really do that, to be honest. You can kind of make it do that, but it doesn't want to do that, because it's... So option number one is this option, bend the leather. So make the sheath without paying too much great attention to the fact that there's this thing here. And then once you've bent it, you're going to need to dampen down this section of the leather and essentially bend it back and bend it up and manipulate it to the fact where you've essentially formed this part of the belt loop around that part of the knife. That's going to give you a fair kink on the back of your leather there, and it's going to give you a kind of bent section inside. But that is the first option that you've got, is to try and bend that out of the way. You'd need to make sure that the leather that you're using for the backing and the belt loop here is thin enough to accommodate that as well. So you may want to use some slightly thinner leather if you're going to do that, to let that bend. Okay, number two option that you've got is ramps, ramp pieces or filler pieces, or whatever you want to call them. If I insert the knife into the leather here, I've just pulled that glue apart a little bit there, hopefully you can see that. If we pull that belt loop something more like more straight, and we let that naturally separate there, and we push the front and the back layers down, you'll see that basically here there is a triangular cavity as such that's formed, a natural triangular shape. As this comes up this way and this comes up this way and these diverge, it creates this triangular hole. Now, another very, very common way to do sheath like this is to essentially fill that hole with leather. And to do that, what you do is you make two ramp pieces, triangular ramp pieces, the same width as your weld, and fit into the top of your weld and tapered down, which then fills this hole. And what that does is that creates a larger opening to your sheath than exists further down here, so that you've actually got a transition that goes down that way, and then you'll say you've got three layers here. You might have five layers up at the top there as you've stuck extra pieces in. And you want to taper those, you want to make those fairly long so that you don't get a stumpy little triangle that looks horrible. You want to make those a little bit longer than you think you need so that you get quite a gradual transition there. That's a very common way of doing a sheath, and it's perfectly acceptable. The only reason you might not want to do that is, depending on how you're doing your sewing, it kind of throws your stitching out, because your awl and so on isn't necessarily going straight front to back, then it's kind of going on a strange angle. If you were drilling your holes for sawing, which some people do, you'll find that your drill wanders right out of line, and it can be a little bit difficult. And it depends how neat you think it is, but that's the option that you've got there, number two, triangular pieces. Alright, the third option that you've got is to have an extra piece of leather that runs the full length of the sheath. And this is something in more recent years that I've done, as opposed to the triangular ramps, because it creates, it kind of keeps the sheath nice and parallel, and it looks a little bit nicer, but it, like everything, it has its disadvantages. So if you imagine here, we've got this back piece here, which includes the belt loop. We've got the welt here, where I've just pulled it apart, and we've got the front piece. If we put triangular ramps in, we'd have an extra little piece there and an extra little piece there. What we could do is we could take a piece of leather. We'll just put some more of that foam. We could take a piece of leather, and what we could do is we could make it quite thick, and we could put that piece of leather on top of the back piece there. So if you imagine, we could stick a piece of leather there like that, and that piece of leather goes all the way down the sheath, so it would be down there and down there, right down to the bottom like that, and then the welt and the front piece would come on as normal. And if we look at that end on, if we can see that there, what we've got then is this piece of leather here, which is in between the welt and the back, that creates a step there. Now obviously this foam's about 2 mil, so that doesn't look like a very thick step, but if you imagine, you could get some thicker leather or laminate some leather so that you could bump that size up a little bit, that creates the distance there that you need for your guard. This works quite well where you've not got too big of a difference. So if you think, oh, I just need an extra 3 mil or an extra 2 mil, that works quite well. Now the disadvantage to this, first of all, if you do it full length, then you increase the overall thickness of the sheath. That makes your sewing a bit more difficult. Second of all, by adding that extra layering, you're increasing the weight. So if this was a long sheath and you think that you've got a long piece of leather, that's quite a lot of extra leather. That increases the weight. On a shorter sheath, it doesn't matter so much. Thirdly, in terms of actually sheathing the knife, you've got to think about where the point of the knife is going. If you have the front piece and the back piece and nothing in between and a fairly big hole, it's quite easy to sheath the knife. If you create this extra piece here, what you're doing is making a small slot that the knife needs to go into, and there's an increased risk of the point of the knife either being inserted in between those two layers of leather where it shouldn't go, or the point of the knife hitting this piece of leather there. So it is slightly more difficult to sheath the knife in that situation. However, if you run it the full length of the sheath, it does create a nice thick parallel sheath, and it's obviously then keeping your sewing nice and straight, which is better, and it's just a little bit neater once you've finished. But again, as I say, it can make it slightly more difficult to sheath the knife. The fourth option that you've got is to use a piece like this, but not run that piece the full length of the sheath. So rather than use a ramp on either side, you use the same stack of piece like that, but instead of running it right down to the bottom, you have it the length that the ramps would be, and then taper it inside the sheath. That is a little bit easier to cut and skive and so on, and it also creates this extra transition at the mouth. So rather than having triangular pieces which create a fairly gaping mouth and don't look as neat, it creates a neater appearance at the mouth there. But rather than running it the full length, you'd essentially have a transition that dropped down there. So where we've got essentially four layers there, we drop down to the three layers down here. So that's your fourth option. So to talk about option number five and six, what I've actually done is I've just cut the top off there now. We're finished with that anyway. And what that's left us with is what you would call a blade-only sheath, essentially. So what this is comprised of is a welt, a front piece, and a back piece. And the front piece and the back piece are obviously mirrors of each other. So that's just three simple pieces. Right back when we penciled around this, and I finished that first bit, I said, if you do a blade-only sheath, this would be the extent of your drawing. That is what you would create from that front, a back and a welt. So you can, option number five is literally to make a blade only sheath. So what you would have on here, on the front there, is a stud, a Sam Brown stud. And a Sam Brown stud can serve two different purposes. It can be as a mounting option, and it can also be a stop for a belt. So Sam Brown stud looks like this. When you mount it, they come in two different types. You can get the screw back type, and you can get this one, which costs a lot more money and is way better. And you can guess what I'm going to say, can't you? These are the ones that I recommend because they're a lot better. These ones that Tandy do are an interference fit. So basically there is no screw. It's a little, that's the little post, and that's the thing. What you do is you hammer them together on an anvil, and believe me, I have wailed on this with as much strength as I can muster, and those things do not come undone. So certainly in normal operation you do not need to worry about these coming undone. This creates a much flatter profile on the back, and it's nice and secure than the screw back ones. I wouldn't bother with the screw back ones. But anyway, these, as I say, these serve two purposes. You can attach a strap to this, and it's an alternate to a snap or press stud. But also, these are used as a belt stop, essentially, or whatever, however you would refer to that. So let's imagine we've made a sheath for this, three parts, as I say, front, back, and welt. You insert the knife into the sheath, and you would, this would be with a fairly big knife, as in not something you'd be worried about coming out. You would be relying essentially on the friction of the pieces here to keep the knife in there. So this wouldn't be something for a tiny blade. This would be more like a Bowie style. And then let's imagine that we've got that Sam Brown stud mounted on the front there. That is actually just a sheath in itself, and some people do make and sell sheaths like this. And the way that that would be worn, rather than hanging off a belt loop, is you insert this between your belt and your trousers, slide it in there, and then this Sam Brown stud stops against your belt like that, and that's it. It's as simple as that. You just basically tuck it into your trouser waistband. It's quite an old-fashioned style. It's not something you'd really see in general production now, a sort of old style or frontier style thing that used to be used years ago. It's very simple and it works, you know. If people want to use it, it's comfortable, it works. So that is the style there. Number five would be a Sam Brown stud and a blade sheath, and it is dealing with this issue of a large guard, because it's kind of cheating. You don't worry about it at all because it's irrelevant how much the guard pucks over there. So it's kind of avoiding the issue. So number six way of dealing with this is to essentially make a sheath like this, the blade sheath with the Sam Brown stud. And you can kind of use these in conjunction because this bit could be optional. But what you do then is you make what's called a frog. Spelled the same, F-R-O-G, frog, that's what it's called. And a frog is it often refers to sword fittings, but you can also use it for this. And essentially it is the piece that is used in conjunction with the Sam Brown stud to actually then attach it to a belt. Now, although I don't have a huge collection of my own sheaths, I'm sure some people think I've got cupboards full, but no, they've all been sold. I do actually have a couple of frog sheaths. So to make this a bit easier, I can actually show you these sheaths that I've made which use this system. This one here, which is the Stuart Barker one, which you might have seen the video of, this uses this system. So there's a blade type sheath here that takes the knife. Blade type sheath that takes the knife. There's the Sam Brown stud on the front, and then here is the frog system. And this solves the problem because obviously the frog system stands back off the blade sheath itself, so that deals with the depth of the handle there. This one is similar again. That's quite a large Guy Stainthorpe knife. Again, there's the sheath that was made with the Stingray inlay. There's the Sam Brown stud that's on there, and then again this is the frog system, and these are removable, you know, so that just pops off. That just pops off so you can see the actual blade sheath underneath. Then that could be used as the blade sheath on its own. And then you've got this system. And there's a few different ways of attaching these as well. You can have ones that slide down. And what you do is, you'd actually permanently close that loop up. So rather than having press studs on there, you'd sew that or rivet that in. And then when this comes down here, you have the hole for the Sam Brown stud, but you also then cut a slit, and that slit then parts for the Sam Brown stud, and the Sam Brown stud then settles in the middle. Or you can do as I've done here, and you can have one that wraps around, so you can attach that to the Sam Brown stud, wrap that around to the back, close your press studs, and that's that obviously then is secure on there. And then again, this gets round, or in this particular example, it's got around the large guard issue by the fact that this has then got a dangler on, and that moves right away from all the guard area, and there's just, you can basically just make that whatever shape you need in order that that then fits the knife nicely and deals with this issue here. So that's number 5 and number 6, either a blade sheath, only a blade sheath, or a blade sheath and a frog system of any kind that you'd like to make. And that really is quite a neat and traditional way of dealing with this issue. Obviously, if you're intent on having a one-piece sheath, this isn't any good, but it's an option that you've got, and they're quite old-fashioned and quite nice as well. So the last way, I say the last way, obviously there's many different ways, but the last way that I'll describe is essentially to have a blade type sheath like this, but then either make a permanent extra back piece or a removable extra back piece. So what you would do is you'd have these three pieces of leather, front, back and welt, and then for the belt loop, you'd use a separate piece. So let's imagine we've got an extra piece of leather like this, obviously longer than that, that's for the belt loop. And what we could do is we could come and attach this on the back here like this. Now what that does is, and obviously as well, you can put even more pieces of leather in between there in order to stand that off any distance. That solves this whole problem of how that fits in there by the fact that you can stack this out however you need to. It solves the problem of thickening the whole sheath. Really the only disadvantage to this is that it's not as neat, because you end up with a transition on the back here, which is unavoidable. So if you want a nice smooth back that runs all the way up, comes around to the other side, you don't get that. You're going to get a transition of some kind here. So as I say, that could either be permanent in terms of you've stitched that right through there, caught your stitching up, and then obviously brought your stitching down and carried it on. Or you could make a whole modular sheath, of like the ones that Hedgehog do and things like that, that are quite popular. You could have a modular system, and often that will be quite a lot longer. So if you look at the recent Hedgehog sheaths that they've done for the Falconeven knives and so on, what they have is they have this blade portion of the sheath. They have probably 6 holes that run through the welt, and then they use little bolts, and then they have a whole back piece that has obviously all the tie downs on and everything like that, and they bolt the back piece to the front piece and stand it off in any way that they need. But again, that avoids this folded belt loop issue. So I hope that makes sense. Obviously that's not very easy to explain without an example of each type of sheath, but unfortunately I don't have time to make one of each type of sheath like that. I'd be here till Christmas. But hopefully the descriptions and the foam bits are enough to understand that there's basically a lot of ways of going around dealing with how you fit the depth of the knife within the sheath. So for the last part of this video now, I'm going to actually finish off and make the K-Bar sheath. There's not going to be anything really that hasn't been in the other videos, to be honest, so it doesn't need a lot of explanation. a couple of things that I have done, because this is now going to be on leather, not foam. Leather has a front and a back. This piece has been reversed, so you'll see that the angle there and the angle there are different. That's because I always cut and mark on the front side of the leather. So if you do vector up a diagram like that, you need to have to flip your back piece. I've made the shape of the belt loop a little bit nicer, and I've also added some shape into the cut outside as well to mirror it a little bit, but that's aesthetic stuff. So I'm going to crack on now with my sort of standard set of steps for this.
For the welt itself, it needs to be as big as the blade stock, essentially. Otherwise the blade's going to force its way in. So if you see what size you've got on the blade, that's about 4.2 millimetres. That leather is 3.2-ish millimetres, so it wants about another millimetre on. Obviously, if you've got a splitting machine, then you're lucky and you can split leather down. If you don't have a splitting machine, you have to go in the other direction, which is laminating it. So what I'll actually do here is I'll find a thinner piece of leather, I'll glue those together, and then I'll cut the welt out of the laminated piece. Cut the three main parts. I'm going to stamp the front of the sheath with a bit of basket. So I'll get that marked in now. So I'll put the 5mm stitching line to it. And then I can double that border up to 10. So I've cut that border in with a swivel knife. I've beveled the border. I've marked a diagonal line, just faintly. And then I've walked to the basket weave stamped down, overlapping the legs, down the line. Once you've set one line of basket weave like that, you basically just build it like Lego, overlapping the legs each time until you get to the edge. Then I'll pop the border on. That's the front marked out. Stitches marked with a pricking iron, border put in there, bit of basket weave done. There's a gap at the top there because it's going to have a roll on top, which is going to be a piece of lining to come over and protect the knife from the stud that will be on there. That's why there's a gap there, because 5mm of that will be rolled over. This piece here, which is the back piece, I'm going to apply a decorative groove to. And then that can be beveled. There's the four pieces I've cut so far. That one's just drying at the moment. So these have been dyed. These belt edges have been burnished. Some Canoba cream on the front sides. And on the inside, where it won't be covered up, some tan coat there. So that's the stage that those are at. The next thing that can be done, because I'll have to work out where the press stud goes, is that I can start to fold this belt loop into shape. But just before I do that, I need to do the skiving on this bottom section here, where it overlaps. It's called skive to nothing there now, which means as the thickness comes down, it ends in a taper to zero, so that when that's folded over and stuck down, the transition there goes completely flat, so there is no step here. Once those pieces come together, once you burnish the edges, it'll just kind of disappear in there. So what I'm going to do now is I'm just going to dampen the fold there, put that to the line, and then just give that a few taps with the hammer just to give that belt loop its shape. And that'll just hold itself down a little bit now that it's been tapped. You may, depending on the thickness of the leather, you may want to take a V-gouge out there, or a couple, to help it fold. But if the leather's folding okay without it, then it's best to avoid doing that, because it's obviously keeping the full thickness of the leather there then. So the next thing to do here is to try and work out the position of the press stud on the front, or obviously if you want to use a sand brown, the position of the sand brown on the front. That needs to be, because I'm going to put a little roll on here to then cover that on the inside, that has to be done now so that all the next stages can happen. So this is the point you get to, which is a little bit awkward, where you basically have to try and put the parts together and sort of dry fit them in your hand, which is never very easy. So all I need to do now is I need to take this piece, which hasn't had any finishes applied yet, and this piece is going to come from inside here over and around to the front. So all I need to do is I need to work out the general position of the press stud on the front. Now, I'm going to put the press stud in. Obviously, you need to make sure that wherever you position your press stud is out of the line of your stitching, because you can't stitch through a metal press stud. So obviously don't come into that last few millimetres there, but you wouldn't really want anything that far over anyway. Now that press stud's set, I can apply the lining. There's no need particularly to line all the inside of the sheath. So it'll have a roll at the top, and it'll come down just past this area here to cover that stud up. And obviously it looks quite nice on the front as well. That was covered in the turn-ins and bindings video that I did, if you want to see how to do that. I'll do that next. That's the little lining applied to that now. As you can see, it doesn't come all the way down the back, it just comes far enough down to catch over that stud
and it also looks nice on the front. Obviously, if you didn't want to do that, there's a few different methods of protecting the inside from studs anyway. You can run a French scaver around your hole and recess your stud back, and as long as you make sure you've recessed it far enough, that should be okay. That's probably the easiest way of doing it. You can apply some lining like that, obviously that does it, or you can apply an extra piece to the front here, like a little shield shaped piece or a circle or whatever you'd like, and attach the stud to that and sew that to the front. That then means there's no metal work on the inside there. The other way you can do this is to cut a little leather disc and attach that to the inside to cover the back of that. I'm never too keen on doing that on something like this though, because the fit of the knife will be quite tight. I think over time that leather disc will get ragged up, whereas on like if you're making like a Leatherman pouch or something where the fit isn't super tight, they're kind of okay, but I would avoid doing that on a sheath like this. Now that welt's stuck to the front piece there, what I can do is pop these pieces back together and work out exactly where this piece needs fitting into the back. Get that fit in there, and then the back and this piece can be closed. What you'll end up then with is just two pieces ready to actually stitch together. So down to two pieces now. I've got this back piece. As I say, I've attached the filler piece on there. That's all glued together. This is all glued and riveted in. So that's all one solid piece. And then the front piece, which is the welt and the front piece. And basically those two pieces now just need gluing and stitching together, and then obviously the edge finishing and so on can be done. What I'm going to do here is I'm going to hammer the pricking iron through these holes in the front here. I'm going to tack these pieces together with a few blobs of glue, get them lined up. I'm going to prick through the holes to make a series of holes on this underside here, and I'm then going to hammer the pricking iron through the underneath piece. Once I've done that, I'll be able to glue these together. There isn't the depth on the pricking iron to go through, obviously, all these layers, because there's actually four layers of leather there now, which is quite, made that quite thick. In fact, there's five layers because it's a laminated welt. So there's actually five layers, and that's way too deep for the pricking iron. But it should be no problem to do it in two stages. So I don't know if you can see that. I've just stuck those two bits together and then pricked through, and I've basically got a series of prick marks now running around there. So what I can do is I can take the pricking iron and go through all those points then, and that means the front and the back should line up nicely, and then I can actually stitch the pieces together. Right, I'm going to stick these parts together now, and what I tend to do is I've got these old needles. I kind of poke a few through the holes at sort of key intervals and line those holes up front and back, so when I put the pieces together, I know that they should be about lined up, and then I sort of just, before the glue sets and everything, I sort of just go down poking a needle through every few holes just to make sure everything's lined up nicely. You can see the needles there just registering everything up. Once you've made sure that there's none of those cockeyed, it just keeps that a little bit sort of lined up right as you squeeze the pieces together then, otherwise it can be quite difficult when you've pre-punched your holes. And then, as I say, with that squeezed together, but before it's had any real pressure applied or hammered to really set the glue, what I'll do then is I'll take another needle and I'll just pick some random holes along the stitch line, and then I'll just make sure that I can go through and that sort of in between the needles as such to make sure nothing's horribly kinked or bored. And as you can see, that needle's going through those holes there without any problems, which means that hopefully when I come up to sewing it won't be too difficult to sew. This is the same thing that I did in the Rat 3 video, by the way. It's just what I did there was drilled the holes, whereas I've tried to avoid drilling these days. I've moved on to using the iron, but you can see exactly the same principle, lined up with the needles, checking with the needles, and then once everything's right, give it a good squeeze and a good hammer and let that set up properly before it's stitched up then. And then obviously all these edges can be trued nicely then. Okay, that's all been stitched around there now. If you watch the stitching video that I did, there's nothing that's been either used or done there that isn't in that video. So that tells you all about it. Stitching's quite nice front and back. So no drills used there, just the pricking irons and then all, and the saddle stitch. And I've just trimmed that curve off. The last thing to do with this is obviously to get the edges sanded down, do all the edge finishing and edge burnishing. And and I've actually fit the retention strap over there and added the stud on as well. The retention on the knife is just as it should be. It goes in easily enough, it comes out easily enough, but it's not
loose in the sheath. So if I shake that without that retention strap on, it's not coming out of there. It will obviously loosen up over time. So if anything, when you make a sheath, it wants to be a little bit tight, and then as it wears in, it'll just come to a nice level. If it's loose on day one, then it could get a bit loose. But that's just nice as it is there. And it's a nice fit. The K-bar knives, the handle's actually off-centred to the blade. If you can see that, they're all like that. When I got this one, I thought it was faulty, but I asked, and they are all like that. I don't actually know the reason for it, if there's a particular reason. So whilst the blade's centred in the sheath, the handle actually appears to be off to one side slightly, and that's just because of the design of the knife. It's not a problem at all. I've done this in some, I don't know if anybody's noticed, but I've done it in matching colours as well. So they've got the light brown stacked leather handle, and obviously the black furniture on the handle there. I've done this is light brown here, that's black kangaroo skin, and that's black stitching, so it actually all matches through kind of nicely. So the last thing to do with this is just to finish the edges off, which is standard. It's been done on lots of other videos. It'll just be sanded on the belt sander, beveled, obviously rubbed down, burnished nicely, and so on. And that's everything that we need to do for this sheath.